Abbas. This is Center University of Abuja Center for Distant Learning and Continuing Education, because it's still ACC 102, Principles of Accounting 2. The study section is 3. In the previous section, we talked about treatments to final account, where we looked at depreciation, prepayment, prepaid income, prepaid expenses, accrued income, accrued expenses, and the bad and doubtful debt. Now we are going to be looking at final account, that is trading profit and loss account and a balance sheet. We are going to be looking at the preparation, and the topic is meant to introduce students to preparation of trading profit and loss account, to have an idea of those items that needs to be posted to the trading profit and loss account, and also how to prepare the balance sheet at the end of each accounting period. The preparation of trading profit and loss account and financial position is the aim or the objective of this section. And we are going to show the format below, this format on the board, on how to prepare your trading profit and loss account and a balance sheet. First, we start with the trading profit and loss account format. Normally, we have two ways in which you can prepare your trading profit and loss account. One is the vertical format and the horizontal format. So we are going to look at the vertical format for now. As trading profit and loss account for the year ended 31st December 2020. The first item that should come to our mind when we talk about trading profit and loss account is the opening stock. Before the opening stock, I would like to say an important thing here. In most cases, when you are asked to draw up an account, there should be a name to that account. Maybe the name of the enterprise. For instance, if you are to draw up an account, we should have, we are just taking this as an example, Wazobia. Wazobia Limited, trading profit and loss account for the year ended 31st December 2020. Then we have the opening stock, the opening stock of finished goods. One thing you should also bear in mind is the fact that though the preparation of trading profit and loss account and that of the manufacturing account seems similar, but in the manufacturing account, we are only considered the raw materials used in the production of goods and services, as well as all other overhead expenses. But in this case, we are going to be looking at those stocks used, or those finished goods stocks that remains, or that we use as our opening stock. So we have our opening stock of raw material. Opening stock of finished goods. It is only when you are asked to prepare a manufacturing trading profit and loss account, then you have to differentiate where you have opening stock. You have to also indicate that it is raw material. But in this case, we are only asked, or we are only interested in showing how you prepare your trading profit and loss account. So what you need to do here is just to show that you have an opening stock. So your opening stock is the first item that comes to this account, followed by the purchases. You add your purchases. There are times, after purchasing some goods, you discover that there are some of it that are damaged or broken. So such damaged stocks can be returned back to the seller. And that will serve as our returns. So we less our returns in returns outward. When you return goods to the seller, you are returning outward. But when a buyer returns goods back to you, then you have what is called the returns inward. So in this case, we have returns outward to be deducted from the purchases. And then we equally have things like carriage inward. And your carriage inward will be added to what you have as your purchases. Now, once you have this, then you are expected to sum it up and add to your opening stock of finished goods. And what you have, or the sum of the purchases plus the opening stock of finished goods, will give you cost of finished goods available for sale, or cost of goods available for sale. You can less your closing stock. Less closing stock. And your closing stock, when you less your closing stock from the cost of goods available for sale, then you definitely have cost of goods sold. Cost of goods sold. Cost of goods sold. Now, this we are using all along, we have been using the debit side of the account. Now it is time to consider the credit side of the account. Once you have all your purchases, your cost and whatever, you should also have your revenue at the credit side of the account, which is the sales. You have your sales. If there is returns inward, it should be deducted from your sales. So, what you have now is the balance of sales. And once you get to this cost of goods sold, you are to deduct the cost of goods sold from what you have as your revenue. So once you deduct the cost of goods sold from the revenue, you'll be having what we refer to as gross profit. Gross profit. have your gross profits here, and then so once you have your gross profits at the debit side, this is supposed to be carried down, because it is the subtraction of the cost of goods sold from the revenue that gives you the gross profit. So once you have a balance carried down, you are supposed to have a balance brought down. So you have your gross profit brought down to the next accounting, which is the trading profit and loss account. Here, from this junction, you are supposed to bring up all your expenses for the period. All the expenses you have for the period are supposed to come into play, so that whatever you have as your gross profit, once you deduct all your expenses from the gross profit, then you can now ascertain whether or not you have made profit or loss. You have, let's assume you have wages for clarity's sake. Expenses, we have wages. We have rent. We can have insurance. We can have depreciation. We can have rates. We can have other expenses, such as general expenses. We can have things like salaries. We already have wages. You may have salaries and wages all separate. You can also have salaries. There are lots of expenses, as the case may be. So it depends on the question you are given that will determine how many expenses you can have. But what we need you to understand is the fact that your expenses should be deducted, the sum of your expenses should be deducted from the gross profit to ascertain whether profit is made or loss is made. So once you have gotten this, you sum it up. When you sum it up, if the expenses side of the account is greater than the income side, definitely you are opt for loss. And if the income side is greater than the expenses side, then you have achieved some benefits, that is income, that's referred to as a profit. But there are times you may not have just the gross profit at the credit side of the account. There could be interest received, which serves as income. There could be a decrease. There could be decrease in bad debt or provision for bad debt. Decrease in provision for bad debt. Then where there is increase in provision for bad debt, it should be written at the credit, at the debit side of this account. Increase in provision for bad debt. You can have commission received. Commission. So any income that comes in the form of receipts is to be taken to the credit side of the account, so that once you have successfully posted all the transactions to the trading profit and loss account, you can now sum the credit side up and sum the debit side up and wait to see which is greater. So let's assume that our credit side is greater, the value at the credit side is greater than the debit side. We definitely have our net profit. Net profit. So this is how it works, and this is how you are expected to post your transactions to the trading profit and loss account. And then the final account that needs to be shown when you talk about final account is the balance sheet. Balance sheet as at that date. Here you have the capital. So it is expected that you have, every businessman have his or her capital that he starts the business with. So your capital is supposed to be shown in the balance sheet. Your capital is supposed to be shown in the balance sheet. So you have your capital at the debit side of the account, because normally the accounting equation says that your assets should take the credit side of the account while your owner's equity takes the debit side of the account. So we start capital, and your capital there should be recorded. You are supposed to add the net profit, if any. Net profit. You are supposed to less any drawings. There are times the owner of the business may take some money from the till and needs to be paid back. So such money taken will not be considered as is the owner's money. It still has to reflect in the books of accounts for transparency sake. So you less the drawings. You add up this to see if there is a progress. So if you have your profit, net profit from the trading account, and then you less your drawings, whatever you have is to be added to what you have as your capital. And then you have also the current liabilities. Current liabilities. Your current liabilities can be in the form of creditors. It can be in the form of prepayment. It can also be in the form of long-term loan. There are times you take long-term loan, and there are times you take short-term loan. If in a business you have long-term liabilities, then it has to be indicated first. So instead of calling it current assets, you say long or medium-term liabilities. Long or medium-term liabilities. So it can be in the form of loan, can be in the form of loan. Then you can have your current liabilities. Like creditors. You can have accruals. You can have, there are times you have, like we discussed, the prepayment of income, something you have received and you are yet to actually deliver the service, the necessary service to it. So such prepayment is considered as liability. So if such is the case, then you can have your prepayment here as your liability. So once you have this, there could be more depending on the question that is before you. So you have your asset side, which is the credit side of the balance sheet, to show the cost of the asset, the depreciation, and the net book value. So if you have, for instance, you have motor van, let's start with plants. You have plants. Maybe it costs an amount to purchase at the time of purchase. And then you have your depreciation. I want us to understand that this place is supposed to be cost of assets, the cost. So because of space sake, just understand that this is the cost of the assets. This is the depreciation. And this is the net book value. Net book value. You have the cost, depreciation, net book value. So once you know the cost of the assets that you are to depreciate, and bring the cost, the book value of that plant, and then deduct the depreciation, whatever remains is your net book value for that asset. You can have motor van. You can have machineries. So whatever you have, whatever it is that is your asset and needs to be depreciated, you have to show it that this is what you have and this is what you are depreciating and this is the net book value of that asset. So after which you sum all your net book value of all the assets, and then have your value. Now you can have your current assets. Current assets. Your current assets can be in the form of cash. It can be in the form of debtors. Can be in the form of stock. Your current assets can be in the form of payment also, depending on the situation. your current assets can equally be in the form of we talked about stock, debtors, cash, prepayment. Yes. So you can have more than these items on your current assets depending on the question that is before you. So, but the most important thing that we need to note here is the fact that at the end of the posting of all the entries, you should have the debit side of this account equal to the credit side of this account. And that is the reason for naming this account as the balance sheet, which is the last stage of final account. In our next class, we are hoping to look at single and incomplete records. Thank you for listening.